Thank you very much for this interesting introduction to the topic of our conference. Now we are proceeding to the first panel discussion, Modernization of Russia and Transatlantic Community. Let me introduce the speakers of the panel in alphabetical order. Mr. Alexander Dynkin, please. Mr. Sven Hirdman, please. Mr. Igor Ivanov. And Mr. Robert Legvold. The panel will be chaired by Andrzej Olechowski.
Good afternoon. I'm sorry for that little break, but we had to agree on some technicalities of the panel. It is my privilege and pleasure to moderate that panel, or rather to facilitate that panel, because I don't intend to intervene too much. I think we have an outstanding menu of participants. And particularly for the Polish audience, we don't have too many of the panels of that quality. So I will try to make sure that you can benefit from every minute of their presence here. We have agreed that panelists will speak in alphabetical order, each of them for about 10 minutes, with the exception of Minister Ivanov, 12 minutes. He's a minister after all, so... 12 minutes. Then we will ask for comments and questions from the floor for about 20 minutes, and then we'll come back to the panel both to answer the questions and perhaps quarrel in between. Gentlemen, I will not make a lengthy introduction, particularly after this magnificent introduction that we had from Madame Carrère-Doncos. Let me say it this way. I am seeing more and more Russians nowadays in my country, all over Europe, all over the world, which is a great pleasure for me because meeting people is one of the ability to meet so many people of so many different nationalities is the most important blessing of this time that we live in. So I'm seeing more Russians, but I'm not seeing Russia any closer than 10 years ago, 15 years ago, or 20 years ago. Somehow, while Russians are closer, Russia is still far away. That this Cold War has been replaced by some sort of a Cold Peace. This was a big ambition of my generation to bring Europeans together, all Europeans together. And I am very proud that I was able to contribute to the unification, if you want, of Western Europe with Central Europe. But Eastern Europe is still far away from us. And the European project will not be completed until Eastern Europe is included. We like in this country to quote Pope John Paul II, who said that Europe has two lungs and they have to work together for Europe to be united. So this part of European project remains an open business, and it has to be completed. The subject of this panel is pretty complicated because we say modernization of Russia and the transatlantic community. Let me say that modernization can be understood differently and is understood differently in different quarters of the world. So I assume that the meaning of modernization is our Western meaning of modernization. Liberal democracy, rule of law, open market economy. In this era, we here, we think that the process of modernization of Russia is slow. That being slow, this also is leading to a situation that while Russians are Europeans, Russia is not of Europe politically. And in that, we are trying to find the key to the future change. So, let us move to this process of modernization. And starting with you, Mr. Dinkin, you're leading a very prestigious institute, which is a source of a lot of knowledge and wisdom. Tell us, why is it so? Why is it slow?
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. You raise very challenging issues. 10 years ago, a friend of mine and my colleague, who I guess in this audience, he wrote an article, I guess the brilliant one. The title of the article was, "Is Russia a part of Europe or apart from Europe?" And I guess we are still in the process of searching the answer for this question. Let me express my sincere appreciation for invitation for the second time to speak in Warsaw in this very splendid atmosphere and splendid environment. And as our host organized, I have a privilege to switch to my mother's language, so I'll continue in Russian. We are talking about modernization, you know, and it's a political slogan as a это политический лозунг, это задача, которую сформулировал президент Медведев несколько лет тому назад. Но я думаю, что Россия находится в стадии вот этой вот ускоренной исторической трансформации, если хотите, модернизации, начиная с начала 90-х годов, а может быть даже с 1985 года, и, конечно, этот процесс не быстрый, я с этим согласен, противоречивый, но он идет. Если вы посмотрите на Россию, скажем, 90-го года и Россию 2010-го года, то я думаю, что любой непредвзятый наблюдатель скажет, что это две очень разные, очень непохожие друг на друга страны. А если говорить о модернизации России и Европы, я думаю, что вот задача такой глубокой общественной, социальной модернизации сегодня и для Европы, и для России это не только условия развития, но, если хотите, на мой взгляд, это даже условия выживания вот в той очень ускоренной динамике глобализации, в тех неопределенностях, которыми мы все сегодня сталкиваемся, поэтому здесь есть вещи, о которых мы можем говорить совместно. Я думаю, что вот такие важные социально дестабилизирующие факторы, которые мы наблюдаем сегодня и в европейских странах, и в России, они во многом схожи, а в будущем я не исключаю того, что они будут практически идентичны. Разрешите мне назвать несколько из них. Уже сегодня мы видим угрозы и цивилизационного, и культурного, и даже этнического размывания ареала нашего проживания. Очевидно, что мультикультурность, надежды на нее сегодня не оправдались, и необходимы другие ответы, которые, я полагаю, мы будем искать совместно. Очевидно, что неадаптируемые мигранты, они сегодня дестабилизируют социумы, вызывают рост национализма, ксенофобии и антиинтеграционных настроений, в том числе в Европейском Союзе. И, конечно, все это препятствует реализации положений Парижской хартии, которая говорила не только о европейской интеграции, но об интеграции в широкой Европе, в то, что называется «Wider Europe». Не случайно мы сегодня видим госпожу Ле Пен в политическом дискурсе Франции как очень неопределенную, но сильную фигуру. Ну, такой довольно карикатурный русский политик, как Владимир Жириновский, его лозунг в нынешних парламентских выборах – это «Россия для русских», и мы должны с открытыми глазами обращать внимание на этот факт. И здесь я не могу не процитировать Адама Михника, который когда-то написал блестящую фразу: «Национализм – это есть высшая и последняя стадия коммунизма», перефразируя известное выражение, которое мы все учили в детстве. Еще один вызов, на который нам придется реагировать совместно, это, конечно, мощная динамика Китая. Это мощная динамика Турции, которая, очевидно, сегодня уходит от идей европейской интеграции. Мы наблюдаем с вами сокращение ответственности Соединенных Штатов за Европу. Очевидно, что Соединенным Штатам сегодня и экономически, и стратегически гораздо интересен Китай. А нас в России очень беспокоит 2014 год, уход войск НАТО и войск Соединенных Штатов из Афганистана. Мы опасаемся реванша Талибана, у нас есть этот печальный опыт. Мы опасаемся дестабилизации в странах Центральной Азии. И в своем пределе есть такой катастрофический сценарий, что в случае падения государства в Пакистане мы сможем столкнуться с ядерным Талибаном. Наконец, очевидно, что и вам, и нам придется соотнести уровень социальных выплат, социальных затрат с конкурентоспособностью и производительностью. Позавчера Международный валютный фонд в очередной раз снизил свой прогноз динамики экономического роста в мире. Международный валютный фонд не исключает сценарий потерянного десятилетия в европейской экономике, как это было в свое время в Японии. И вот это несколько факторов, которые, на мой взгляд, важны, которые говорят о необходимости взаимодействия и тесного сотрудничества. Теперь, что нас разъединяет? Здесь я назову две вещи. Но первое, совершенно очевидно, это проблемы с развитием демократии в России. Я думаю, что 70 лет коммунизма, слабость демократических традиций, эти вещи понятны, особенно в Варшаве, особенно в Польше. Поражение буржуазной революции в России в феврале 1917 года привело к реставрации фактически феодальных институтов в их худшем диктаторском варианте. Поэтому, конечно, наш путь из ГУЛАГа в Гайд-парк, он гораздо более сложный, чем, скажем, для Праги или Варшавы, и это историческая реальность, и к ней надо относиться, опять же, с открытыми глазами. И это реальность. Вторая вещь, о которой я хотел сказать, она, на мой взгляд, скорее фантомна. Это, наверное, та коллективная память, о чем говорил господин Клейбер в своих вступительных замечаниях, но это конфронтационность, это взгляд друг на друга через призму холодной войны, взгляд во многом милитаризованный, отталкивающий, чего бы это ни касалось, и экономики, и социальных вещей, и проблем безопасности. И, конечно, этот подход имеет много сторонников и в России, и в европейских странах. И вот в этой среде возникают такие диковинные персонажи и режимы, как, например, Минск, который сегодня великолепно маневрирует и играет на вот этих реликтовых настроениях и неплохо себя чувствуют. Я думаю, что есть такие достаточно сильные группы политических интересов, особенно, скажем, в странах Балтии, которые заинтересованы в консервировании вот этих коллективных страхов, желаний, стремлений играть на них. Скажем, когда мы вспоминаем такой термин, как суверенная демократия, ну, ни один серьезный аналитик в Москве как бы с уважением к нему не отнесся. Сразу и президент Медведев, и академик Примаков публично осудили этот тезис, а его распевали, так сказать, группы таких ручных агитаторов, или сегодня они называют себя политологами. Я не уверен, что Наталья Нарочницкая, с которой мы учились вместе в аспирантуре, работали в одном институте, близка к премьер-министру. С ее перепевами евразийства, которое было популярно среди интеллектуальной миграции в 30-е годы. Я думаю, что наш министр иностранных дел, господин Лавров, не менее близок к премьер-министру, и он несколько раз публично и в своих статьях говорил о том, что Россия – это часть европейской цивилизации, точно так же, как и Соединенные Штаты. Вот это евразийство сегодня уже, ну, не является таким фокусом политической дискуссии в Москве. А мы сегодня воспринимаем Россию скорее как евро-тихоокеанскую державу, или то, что называется Euro-Pacific State, и в этом направлении как бы вот идет дискуссия, как точнее реализовать вот эту вот идентичность. Я не знаю, сколько времени я уже говорю, господин Олеховский? So I'll say one more.
Okay. Thank you so much. Ambassador in Moscow. So that is the reason why we would like to see to hear your view on modernization and on what divides us. What are the challenges that we have meet to get closer together? Please, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Well, the subject of this panel is very vast, the modernization of Russian transatlantic relations. I suppose you could talk about anything under that heading. I want to talk about two things, the physical modernization of Russia, firstly, and then about Russia's relations with the West. And I'll try in 10 minutes to throw 10 points to, 5 on modernization and 5 on foreign policy. Now, on the modernization of Russia, my first point would be that two of the most significant events in Russia in the last 20 years have been the two economic crises. From the crisis in 98, Russians, I would say all Russians, understood that Russia must have a balanced economy, a sound financial and macroeconomic policy. Everyone understood that, the communists, Zhirinovsky, everyone. That was the first lesson from that crisis. Then there was the crisis in 2008, which also came as sort of something from the outside and hit Russia. And the lesson from that crisis was that Russia can't do everything on its own. Russia must modernize, but it must have foreign investments, it must have foreign technology that has and will have a profound influence on Russia's policy in all respects, also on foreign policy. Russian government understand that it must behave in a more friendly way towards other countries. Now, looking back, my second point, over the last 20 years, as Mr. Dinkin said, certainly there has been impressive modernization in Russia. I remember coming to Moscow in 94. We had to fill up, when we wanted to fill up our cars with petrol, there were no petrol stations. We had to go find a tank, a lorry coming with petrol to the embassy and fill up our cars. Now look at all the petrol stations, not only in Moscow, but all over the country. There has been a significant modernization of transport in Moscow, in the provincial capitals. You have the retail sector, you have the IT sector, you have the financial sector. So there is modernization in Russia. What's interesting is that there is a new force for modernization in Russia from the new middle class. Now, various estimates, some say it's up to 30% of Russian population, but it's a significant force, 20, 30, 40 million people who used to be apolitical, only interested in their own material well-being, not interested in politics. But now then, when they have achieved their material well-being, and they look around and they don't like everything they see. They don't like the bureaucratic price wall, the bureaucratic arrogance. They don't like the migalki. They don't like all the restrictions on their life and what they can say or what they cannot say. And that has sort of forced politicians and bureaucrats to become more defensive and also more accommodating. And this is not only happening in Russia. We see now the same development in China, in India, and in Brazil. And this means that Russia is becoming now, in the last 2-3 years, a more open society. And that's very good, and that's part of the modernization. Now, I believe that the main issue for the modernization of Russia is the modernizing the, in many ways, decrepit infrastructure. By 1973, the Soviet Union was a rather modern country. I didn't work in Russia in 73, but I worked there in 64, 66. It was a rather modern state, I would say, up to 73. But then after 73, the oil crisis, all the money spent on the rearmament, the competition with the United States, made destroyed the Russian or the Soviet economy. And during the 90s, the Russian government had no money at all to spend on infrastructure. In the 2000s, 2001 to 2008, there was money in the Russian state coffers, but that money was spent on the social needs of the population and also sensibly to build up reserves for new economic crisis. And only by 2007, one started to talk about infrastructure programs, $650 billion for building 10,000 kilometers of roads, 3,000 kilometers of railways, and so on. But then there was the economic crisis of 2008, and it was postponed. Now again, after the economic crisis, there is a renewed interest, new 10 and 20 years plans for investing in infrastructure. I think this is extremely important. It's extremely important that Russia gets decent roads. You remember what was said, that Russia had two problems, Duraki and Dorogi, and it's still true. Railways, bridges, power station, everything has to be, not everything, but a lot has to be rebuilt and renovated, and you need money for that. And Putin and others have understood this, and I think that's important. And I would submit that for Russia, for the present-day Russia, it's more important to concentrate on this basic infrastructure program than on high technology. It's more important to build roads, railways, houses, social institutions, than to spend money on nanotechnology, space research, and so on. And I would, again, sticking out my neck, say Russia should not compete with the United States in high technology. It should compete with Switzerland in infrastructure, if you want to have a modern Russia. Now, a few points then, 5 points on Russia's relations with the West. And I would say this, compared to the situation during the last century, there are no longer any serious military security threats in Europe. A new real war in Europe has become unthinkable, undoable. But still, tension and fears continue to exist. And these are partly based on concrete historical experiences, for instance, between the Balts and the Russians, or on long-standing prejudices, fears, which I would say is the case in Sweden and the United States, and for that matter, in Russia also. So what can be done? And my view is that you can only reduce these fears and prejudice, which creates these fears of insecurity, which are the real security problems, by attacking them from the bottom. That is, with more people-to-people contacts. You were talking about Russians coming to Poland, they're coming to Sweden. I think it's extremely good. And the most efficient way to promote such people-to-people contacts is to remove the visa restrictions between Russia and Western countries and encourage more mutual travel and getting to know each other. Of course, if Russia was less nationalistic and less prestigious, it could set, it should set the path and unilaterally abolish visas for Western citizens. The best diplomatic policy is often unilateral, not bilateral, unilateral, acting in one's own interest, not making oneself hostage to what the other side wants or does not want to do. The other way to increase understanding, again from bottom up, and reduce the feelings of insecurity is to form a free trade area as soon as possible between Russia and the EU. And first, of course, by getting Russia into the WTO. and then by establishing a free trade area with the EU. That would bind the nations, that would bind their economies and their populations closer together. As President Johnson said, it's better to have the world than outside the tent. And that was a policy that WTO practiced towards China. Do the same immediately with Russia. Now, in the field of sort of traditional security policy, there are a few useful steps that could be taken. The first one would be for the Western countries to immediately ratify the adapted CFE treaty, the Conventional Forces in Europe treaty, which has not been ratified. If that would be done, it would impose ceilings on the force levels in most European countries and remove a bone of contention. It would be a goodwill measure. And in the wake of such a measure, one could take a new look at the problem of Transnistria, which I think is solvable. And another sort of promising measure would be to start talks on the stationing of tactical nuclear weapons in Europe, American ones, and Russian ones in Western Europe. That would also create some good atmosphere. And finally, my last point is this. In this context of traditional security policy, I, for one, do not believe in the idea of building a European anti-missile system. I suspect it's not technologically viable. It only risks creating more tension between Russia and the United States. If the concern is Iran's nuclear policy and missile programs, the only and best way to attack that would be for the Americans to sit down with the Iranians and try to sort of resolve that problem. And the same goes, of course, for North Korea. The development of anti-missile programs and the stationing of ABMs is, as Eisenhower once said, I would say, something, or, you know, the military-industrial complex wanting to accomplish its mission. Nothing more than that. Thank you. I think I've been within 10 minutes.
Thank you. I'm truly impressed. 10 minutes. Lovely. Minister, 12 minutes. Perhaps you will find one of them.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I asked 2 minutes more because I think that I can have this chance because I am only present here who worked with Geremek. That's why I will start with some memories on Geremek, and after that we'll try to speak about modernization. I worked with Bronislav for 2 years together. We were ministers in 1999 and in 2000. And if you remember, it was a quite difficult period for diplomats. I don't speak about other people of other professions, but for diplomats, not easy. It was the period of enlargement of NATO, the period of enlargement of European Union, the period of aggression of NATO against Yugoslavia, and other difficult problems in our discussion. And we had long and constructive discussions because I wanted to understand why after the Cold War, and when, from my point of view, we had the perfect chance to start to create new security community in Euro-Atlantic space, why it was necessary, the enlargement of NATO. I will be very frank, I don't have any position now, but still today I don't understand why it was necessary with enlargement. I don't ask anybody. I am telling what I don't understand. I know what other people will try to say me about the rights of democratic states, about Western values and many other things. Well, this is maybe, and that discussions we had with Bronislav. But I am sure that Bronislav thought that it was the best way for Poland, the best way for the future of Europe, and it was my respect to listen to him. But from now, when we are speaking with, you say, after the Cold War, we are still in cold peace, because I think that we lost the real chance to create new security system in transatlantic space after the Cold War. They lost the other chance to create after the September 11th, and now we have maybe the third good chance, and now we are really speaking. And for example, many of us, we are coming from Kyiv, where we are discussing precisely the issues of Euro-Atlantic security in the 21st century, and we speak that it's necessary, the first thing, undivided security. And enlargement, it was to confirm the division of security in Euro-Atlantic space. We are speaking about the trust, and I think that this is the big issue, the trust, not the threat. I don't think that during the enlargement of NATO, many countries thought about real threat from Russia. Russia was struggling in favor of maintaining the territorial integrity and to save our own country, not to attack some other countries. But that's why long, difficult discussions we had. During his first visit, after 4 years, we had the first visit of Minister of Foreign Affairs of Poland to Moscow in January 1999, and we started the discussions. And I think that he was very constructive because trying to explain the position of Poland, at the same time he was listening. He was listening and trying to understand the other position. And that's why we agreed and we started with him to make a list of problems from both sides and trying to resolve that problems. And after that, I continued the same work with Bartoszewski and with Cimoshevich. And I am very glad that other ministers, Adam and other people, continue this work. And now we see that working together and trying to understand each other, it is possible to resolve the most difficult issues in bilateral relations. And this is because after that alone discussions and trying to understand each other, we create the conditions of trust. And only with the conditions of trust and knowing very well the history and thinking about the future, we can go ahead. That's why I had very good experience with Geremek. I repeat, I want to say frankly, we had not easy discussions because positions were very different, but it was interesting, and for me it was he was the person who demonstrated how it is necessary to deal with the most difficult issues. This is 2 minutes. Now coming to the modernization with other 10. Thank you very much. Speaking about modernization, I will say about only some things. I think that Russia and Europe have different starting position in the modernization race, but the racing track is the same or very similar, and the stakes are very high for both Russia and Europe. If Russia falls behind in the modernization race, it will continue its slide down to become a purely raw materials producer, completely depend on fluctuations of global energy prices. The remaining scientific, cultural, and educational potential of the country is likely to decay further, which will ultimately deprive Russia not only of the position of a great power, but that of an independent actor in global politics. For Europe, a failure to respond to the modernization challenge would result in maybe less dramatic, but no less serious consequences. One can foresee a chronic economic stagnation, rising social tensions, and political instability. A very important question for Russia and for Europe in this context is about our position versus each other in this modernization race. Are we competitors or potential partners? Are our interests in the age of globalization clashing, converging, or diverging? Let me be very frank here. Not everybody in my country consider Europe to be a natural partner and ally to Russia in the area of modernization. Many skeptics would say that Russia should rather try to partner with global modernization leaders of today. Today, the United States, or future East Asia. Of course, in Europe, there are plenty of skeptics as well. They see no particular value in partnering with Russia. Such a partnership, in their view, has maybe negative impact on the European economic and political system. If this logic of both sides prevails, it is easy to predict that Russia and Europe will drift apart. We will continue to be united by geography, common history, day-to-day economic interests, but strategically we will pursue diverging trajectories. Is there an alternative to this scenario? I am deeply convinced that an alternative does exist, and the alternative is embedded in something that unites Russia and Europe even stronger than common history and geography. Russia and Europe have always taken pride in the quality of their human capital. It is exactly the human capital, not the resource base, production capacity, or financial resources that constitutes the foundation of the contemporary modernization trends. The quality of the human capital is the defining factor in the quest for modernization. And to accumulate the human capital, you need to enjoy an appropriate cultural environment, systems of general and higher education, research and innovation centers. In Europe and in Russia, there are strong traditions of human capital building, and there is an environment that stimulates its growth. We have a lot to offer each other in this field. Let me emphasize once again, in the modern world, economic modernization is meaningless without social modernization. And social modernization, in its turn, is impossible without a critical evaluation and further reinvention of the major social institutions. It is often argued that in Russia, as well as in Europe, the social infrastructure is too expensive, that social costs are an obstacle to a more efficient and dynamic economy. The conclusion is that in order to move ahead, we need to abandon the idea of social state and to dismantle its components. But should we take the risk of depriving ourselves of the most significant comparative advantage that we still have? Or rather, should we try to preserve what we have by enhancing the efficiency of our social state? In my view, these questions are equally important for Europe and for Russia. If this assumption is right, we should try hard to activate our interaction in identifying ways to increase the efficiency of our respective human capital. That involves a very diverse range of all issues: education and national research strategies, culture management and social care, public health and migration policies, community development and environment protection. Industrial production might flee to China or Indonesia. New technologies may gravitate to the Silicon Valley or Bangalore. But if we do it right, the human capital will remain the main comparative advantage of Europe and Russia, or, saying by other words, of greater Europe. Finally, I have to say that such a Russian-European partnership in modernization is feasible if we are able to successfully handle the traditional agenda in our relations. Unfortunately, we do have a lot of residual problems that go back to the period of the Cold War. The notion of modernization can and should be applied to the system of international relations in Europe, the system that remains, to a large extent, archaic and inefficient. Should we tolerate the old, outdated concepts of European security like deterrence, containment, balance of powers, and so on? Or should we rather try to break out of the old logic and come up with a modernized agenda for the European security? Imagination and political will can overcome bureaucratic inertia and old habits. Just have a look at the remarkable progress achieved over the last year and a half in the Russian policy relations. If we were able to reach a breakthrough at the bilateral level, why don't we try to do the same at the multilateral level? Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Professor Legvold, how is the reset working? How important it is for United States?
Is this on now? Well, I was actually going to speak about the issue of modernization, Russia and Europe, as an outsider, as an American. In terms of the question that you put to me in three sentences, I think there has been a remarkable turnaround in the U.S.-Russia relationship that no one in this room would deny since the Nader in 2008 after the Georgian War and where U.S.-Russian relations, Russia-Western relations were, with very considerable accomplishments, both in terms of the New START agreement, the activities within the U.S.-Russia binational presidential commission, the way in which the two sides think about one another and the possibilities of improving relations, but it remains enormously fragile. And there are sharp critics of it on both sides, depending on the way in which politics evolves, particularly in my country, less so in the case of Russia. The Obama administration and their senior people, despite the reports that you read, as they anticipate the results of the Russian presidential election in March, whatever they are, expect continuity. It's very difficult to predict the same thing in the case of the United States after November of 2012 if there is major leadership change. But the progress is real, and it's been important, and it's obviously had an impact on the question that we're talking about today. The question we're talking about today has struck me for some time now in terms of the narrow perspective that most of us outside judges, particularly the Russians on the inside, bring to the topic. It is, I think, understandable that the perspective would be narrow, that it would be short-term, that it would be impatient. But when it is that, the emphasis on the failings, the emphasis is on all the frustrations that are around the Medvedev program of modernization or the progress we are or not making in integrating Russia with a Europe. Russia is not going to be integrated into Europe and its institutions of NATO and the EU, but integrating Russia with Europe. And that's easy enough to do because notwithstanding the arched and ambitious and very correct language that's used, the program that Medvedev has laid out since 2009, and even its operational aspects, which are very impressive and which you hear very few people talking about, the notion is that it hasn't gotten very far. A number of us in this room, including Alin, were at a conference a year ago that was devoted to, within Russia, that was devoted to this question of modernization. There was a sharp divide between the non-Russians and the Russians who were there. Most of the Russians who were there not only judged the Medvedev program of modernization a failure, they judged it cynical. They judged it as pokazuka, as essentially something that was being used politically to manipulate the situation. The non-Russians recognized that there were very real limitations to what had happened or not happened in the case of modernization, but they tended to focus on the obstacles and the reasons that it was so difficult to proceed with modernization. Now, I'm not suggesting that all Russians fit into that camp, and most of the Russians who are in this room do not necessarily fit into that camp. And it is easy to focus on the failings. It is easy to focus on what's not happened since 2009 when you learn that the World Economic Forum and its Global Competitiveness Survey has reduced Russia from the 63rd place to the 66th place in 1 year, from 2010 to the present period. It is easy to say that things aren't working well when most of the major bond rating agencies, including S&P and the others, award Russia a rating of second lowest investment grade or third lowest investment grade, and that doesn't change. It is easy to think things are not going well if I tell you the direct foreign investment in Russia in the first 6 months of this year was $7 billion and capital flight was $31.2 billion, four times as much, nearly 4% of GDP within Russia. Doesn't sound like things are going very well. But I would start in a different fashion with a longer historical perspective. And I would ask myself as an American, you as Europeans, the rest who are Russian within the room, two questions. First of all, what are going to be the costs if this fails? Not merely to Russia, but to all the rest of us. You heard Igor and you heard Alexander as they laid out the implications of whether it's trends around demography or whether it is the failure to rebuild infrastructure that Ambassador Herdman spoke about, or if you listen to what Igor Sergeyevich had to say about what Russia would be reduced to without failure along those lines. And what will it mean for the rest of us? That's the other side of the question. What would success mean for us in this context? Before the economic crisis in 2008, Russia was on the verge of becoming Europe's largest consumer market. In addition to the human resources, the innovation potential within that country, its geographical location and importance, the basic proposition, if you think beyond the decade that we're in now, which is going to be a difficult one, with very low growth and very little prospect of rapid progress, if you're looking for the next region that'll look like Asia and the Tigers, it isn't going to be Africa, it isn't going to be Latin America, it isn't going to be the Arab Spring in the Middle East, it'll have to be what we call the post-Soviet region. And that's in terms of the global economy. I'm speaking in the next 20 years. I'm not talking about the next 5 years. The second thing that I would say is, in addition to focusing or rushing to the focus on the failings, which are very considerable, and for all the reasons that we know, Alexander began to lay them out at the outset, but it's institutional failure, it is inefficient labor markets, it's undeveloped banking system, it's absence of rule of law, it is insecure property rights, it's everything. We know what the list is along the way. But the next question that I would ask is, what is the significance of what Ambassador Herdman said at the outset, that Russians, for the most part, informed, including the Russians who are here, understand the problem? No one has described the issue better or what the objective should be or what modernization should be than the president and others around him, including advisors like Arkady Dvorkovich and the others that work in this area. There's nothing that we know or that we could advise or be wiser on than they are in the circumstance. And it's not just the good words. It's not just the five areas that they want to work on for energy, for modernization of increased energy efficiency, working in terms of medical technology and pharmaceuticals, nuclear power, space, communication. Those are the areas. And I don't disagree with Ambassador Herdman when he says that the real priority should be infrastructure, not an IT competition with the Americans. That's true, but I actually think both can be done. I do agree that the first priority ought to be infrastructure, but not at the expense of being able to do what you do in the other areas. And when you look at what they're talking about, when I talk about the operational program that nobody pays attention to in the outside world, of what these, how these five things are to be done, it's very impressive. It's quite on the mark. In the case of IT technology, it is a super consortium of 25 universities to deal with the development of supercomputers. It is e-government. It is e-health. It is e-education, that is electronic, and all of those areas and the way in which that is to be developed. If you look at the issue of energy efficiency, the operational program has improved counters and records scoring in the use of energy. It is the development of local facilities for producing electricity. It's a wide range of five or six things, all of which are very intelligent. In the case of nuclear power, it is the development of new power stations with VVER technology. It is the internal fuel cycle. It is fast neutron reactors. All of these are part of the program. Now, That means that the ideas are in place. People understand what needs to be done. The obstacles are very considerable, but the pressure to move in this direction in the longer run, it seems to me, is there. And if I were to take a 20-year perspective, if I start with the notion that understanding the problem properly is your first advantage and the first requirement, I'm willing to wager that the Russians are going to make it. I'm willing to wager that this modernization is going to go forward. It will be very slow in the near term for all the reasons that have been laid out up to this point. But my final point is we all have a very high stake in Russia achieving it. The only last thing I would say in terms of Russia and Europe itself, here I think Sergei Karaganov and his friends that have written this piece arguing that unless there is cooperation between Russia and Europe, the formation of a working partnership, both are going to be marginalized. I don't care what Russia's aspirations are in Asia. Unless Russia and Europe pull together, both will be marginalized in the world that we're facing 15 years down the road. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Now, 20 minutes for the audience. I can see two hands already up. Marcin Święcicki, then Andrzej Lubowski. Yes? Okay. I'm afraid you have to come. Absolutely. You have to come here. Oh, we do have a mic. Okay.
Go ahead. Okay, Marcin Święcicki. As we all know, the approximation with European Union is a great force of modernization in this part of the world after communism time. And right now, Ukraine is negotiating association agreement with European Union, and this association agreement can become really a powerful force in modernization of Ukraine. So I have a question, why Russia is so much against this association agreement between Ukraine and European Union, is offering to Ukraine enormous discounts in billions of dollars for gas prices if Ukraine does not join the association agreement, is on the other side threatening Ukraine with a blockade of the importation of agricultural products, steel products, high-tech products from Ukraine if Ukraine signs the association agreement. Is this a kind of the distrust to European Union and its modernization? Is this an old thinking of the sphere of influence? Russia, I think, is seeing its chance also in cooperation with European Union, for example, through modernization and other kinds of agreements that would facilitate modernization, economic modernization in particular of Russia. So why is this such an attitude towards Ukraine that we see in the recent months?
Thank you so much. Andrzej Lubowski, please. I don't know. Marcin Święcicki was a former minister of foreign trade here in the 90s. Andrzej Lubowski is a journalist, both Polish and American. Go ahead.
An American banker and a Polish journalist. How do you like the combination? I was somewhat puzzled by the last speaker, honestly. In other words, what we heard is the obstacles are known. There is nothing we can teach Russians. They know what hurts them, and therefore we should almost celebrate. In other words, things will, if that's the case, and I think it is, I mean, everything we heard from our distinguished Russian speakers shows that they know what the issues are. But if that little happens, if the progress is so slow, what's the reason? To what extent, how can we explain something that looks like impotence? To what extent the fact that and what's hurting, what needs to be corrected, and so little happens, to what extent that means that something else is happening in the country and the other forces are in command. And quite recently, one of the leading Russian sociologists, Mr. Nazemtsov, wrote a very powerful piece entitled, I don't remember the title, but if I were to title it, it would be Russia, the Kingdom of Nepotism. And nepotism is not a very good economic advisor. So my question is, yes, that's true. Russia, or at least some Russians, know what the issues are, but the pace of progress is extremely and surprisingly slow.
Thank you. Mr. Becker, please. And please do introduce yourself, because I do know some of the people, most of the people, but I don't know everybody. So,
Markus Meckel, I for a long time was a parliamentarian in Germany. I would like and raise a question of society. We usually speak about cooperation between European Union and Russia as states or European Union as a union. But I think it is very important to improve the cooperation with society. And the visa issue and meeting people, I think, was mentioned. I think this is a crucial point. And that needs to ask the question, what kind of ruling has to be modernized in Russia? This brings the question to democracy. And open society needs to be developed, and it's the resource of modernization. The second question is related to the question of modernization of administration. What does it mean, federalism, in Russia? Which kind of independency, autonomy, the federal subject has to have in the future, in your view? How the problems of identity, of different identities, have to be solved, for instance, especially in the north of Caucasus, where I can't see that there is really a vision of solving the problems with that kind of ruling Russia today.
Thank you, sir. Who else would like to ask the question or make a comment? There will not be another chance. Nobody. Okay. absolutely. Professor, we'll start with you this time. Please, you answer the questions whichever you think you would like to, and also if you want to somehow react to what our colleagues at the panel said, please go ahead.
Well, I won't try to respond to all three questions, or the third question, which was, in fact, three questions in addition. But the point that was made about the second question, first the notion that the way in which I phrased the issue, one wonders at the end whether I'm not really saying that we ought to celebrate this paralysis or impasse. That clearly is not my message. My message is that we all ought to be concerned about whether Russia succeeds or not. But the heart of the issue is of that question. What is truly useful in the question is why this process has been so slow. Why, in order to have a modicum of optimism, I have to use a 20 or 25-year perspective and can't talk about the next 5 years, the next 10 years in optimistic fashion. I would say several things. It's clear that the obstacles that academician Dinkin laid out at the beginning of his presentations are real and they're durable, and they're not conditions, that is, obstacles that have been created yesterday so can be removed tomorrow. They're obstacles that have accumulated over a very long period of time. They are the legacy of the Soviet Union. They even, in many respects, are the effects of imperial Russian history. And certainly the nature of the system, the dysfunction of it, but also the fact that this is a country still in transition. People who believe that that Putinism as a system is a resting point for Russia, having gone through the Gorbachev and Yeltsin transition, I don't think understand what's happening in Russia. This is still very much transitional, and an important part of the transition is the incapacity of government, the weakness of the state, the inappropriateness of the bureaucracy, and a bureaucracy that still doesn't understand the function of regulation versus the function or the right of control or decision. It is also very much one of the things that happens in a transition like this that may be natural but very corrosive, and that is the degree of corruption. Here I've disagreed with Russian friends at times who, in the face of this, have said, well, it's natural. We have to go through this. We're learning how to cope with it. We'll grow out of it. Anybody who studies corruption, whether it's Indonesia or Nigeria or elsewhere, knows that this is not simply transitional and that you grow out of it easily. It's very difficult to grow out of it. And the corruption is growing in Russia. I don't care whether it's the impressionistic results of Transparency International that has reduced Russia in the ranking each year for the last 10 years, so it's not merely year to year, which would be unpredictable, or the fact, as the director of Rosfinnadzor said the other day, that building a highway in Russia today, which costs 2 to 3 times more than it costs to build it in the U.S. or in Europe, is because 40% of that cost is corruption. Or that $174 billion, as judged by the head of the Economic Security and Anti-Corruption Administration within the Ministry of Interior, has said $174 billion over the last 15 months in suspicious transfer outside. He's referring to kickbacks through contracts, construction, and otherwise that end outside. He's talking about illegal sale of alcohol in the gray market that end up on the outside, $174 billion. All of that is part of this transition that has to be fought. And one of the essential questions, be interesting what our Russian colleagues say, of why the anti-corruption campaign, I mean, the serious effort in this direction was launched by Medvedev, at least rhetorically, at the end of 2009, along with modernization, even before that, with legislation. But quite frankly, as someone who's followed this, this was the fourth time it had been done, 3 times before by Yeltsin in the 1990s. And the real question is one of the reasons why you can't deal with it easily. And I think an important part of that is because you're not dealing with corruption the way in which one normally understands it. You're dealing with what I think can be described, as the World Bank describes it, the EBRD before that, as state capture. This is not simply bureaucrats that are willing for a bribe to allow somebody to work their way around the regulation. This is a system where you can buy legislation, where you can buy regulation. That's state capture. And that means collusion between the state and those who are on the corrupt side. At virtually every level of government, I think you have essentially partnership. And until there's a willingness, someone or others, forces to transform that, I think it'll remain. Then I finish quickly. I won't say more. I think one of the reasons why it's slow, but also one of the reasons why I believe it'll happen, is because change in Russia today, from my point of view, is occurring differently for the first time at any point in a millennium. Change in Russia, often dramatic, has always come from above, has always been imposed from above. Russia today, to the extent that it really is changing from below and organically. And as we know in our own societies, our 150-year, our 200-year histories, from the period of feudalism to the Industrial Revolution, when it changes from below, it is slow and it is messy. And therefore, on the corruption issue, Dmitry Trenin, I think, has made an argument very well in the past. The Russians aren't going to, in the near term, in terms of democracy and what they're looking for, demand civil rights and the first 10 amendments to the U.S. Constitution. What they will demand is good governance, as clean governance, as this middle class that you referred to, Ambassador Herdman, and new business people and others begin to look at where their real interests are. But that's a very slow process that faces all of these impediments. So I'm not surprised that it's slow. And I'm not, I don't mean to be Pollyannish about the prospect that in the end it'll triumph, but it does seem to me that the large forces over the longer run are likely to move in the right direction.
Well, I will try to answer question by question. The first question about Ukraine. We are coming from Kyiv. Yesterday we were there, and I had time, I tried to speak with my Ukrainian colleagues, trying to understand what is the problem. As I see, maybe I'm wrong, our Ukrainian friends, from one side, they want to have privileges of custom agreement between Russia, Belarus, and Kazakhstan. Without be part of that agreement, they invented formula 3+1. On the other side, they want to have association agreement, I don't know, a special relations with European Union. It means Ukraine is an independent state and can take decision what Ukraine wants to. But what you cannot, and this is not political, this is economic issue, you cannot sign agreement with one organization and trying to receive the privileges, having a special relations with that, and at the same time asking some a special formula for you to have lower prices on gas. That's why this is Ukraine who has to decide, and nobody can impose to Ukraine any decision. I don't see, as maybe I'm wrong, I don't see the future on a short period between Ukraine and European Union, seeing what is the internal situation in European Union. But I repeat, this is the case of Ukraine and European Union. But Ukraine has to decide. If they decide, from my point of view, as I said publicly there, this is the Ukraine, for Ukraine, for interest of Ukraine, is to have good relations with the European Union and to have good relations with the other side, the custom agreement. This is, I think, that logical for Ukraine and for any other country today in the globalized world. That's why, but I repeat, this is the decision of Ukraine which has to be taken in Ukraine and not in Moscow. It's clear that on the other side, there is strong competition in the world between different countries, between different companies. And sometimes we are trying, when there is competition for markets, saying this is political. Not only political, this is also economic reasons, which sometimes create serious problems. We can compare also, for example, some people in Ukraine asked me, why you decided to realize this with Adam, we discussed yesterday, this North Stream pipeline, and now trying to construct South Stream. I was here in Poland asking about the pipeline through the territory of Poland, with two governments here trying to convince Polish politicians to construct the pipeline through Poland. But they said no, and in Ukraine we had problems and we constructed on North Stream, and now they ask Ukraine, say no, let us decide not to construct South Stream but go through territory of Ukraine. This is not joke, this is serious problem with the amount of huge monies, and if it, politically you take decision, not easy decision, at the same time if European Union decide to construct Nabucco, They have this legitimate right to construct Nabucco, and there will be more pipelines. That's why I think that Ukraine, this is the, in Ukraine inside, they have strong discussion, political inside Ukraine. This is not only with Russia. With Russia it is now Yanukovych will go to Moscow to decide to discuss prices on gas. Because, I repeat, they want, that's why Timoshenko is in jail. But she was prime minister signing the agreements with the Russian government, and now they say, no, She didn't have right. Now let us revise that this is not a joke. This is serious, billions of dollars. And Russia is not so rich, but is not so rich to make such gifts to other countries, also to our brothers, friends from Ukraine. That's why I don't think that this is, we try to impose, are you with us or European Union? I think that the future of Ukraine is to have good relations with European Union and to have good relations with Russia. It's clear that I don't think that in many years, I don't see the clear future of the membership of Ukraine in European Union, seeing many problems which they are, but this is a special relations they can have, and I think that they have also to find conditions for special relations with Russia and the custom treaty. Now, you say that Russians know what to do, but don't do. Well, sometimes you know, but you cannot, because some people see one way, the other people see different way how to do it and by what way to do it. From my point of view, with my proper experience, for example, I will say it was big mistake speaking about corruption, for example, till today, not to permit Russia to be member of WTO, for example, because the membership impose special conditions. I negotiated for 4 years with Council of Europe about membership of Russia in the Council. And I remember very well some lords from Great Britain and from Luxembourg trying to teach me, saying why Russia was not ready to be member of Council of Europe. I said, I agree, we are not ready, but we want to be there, and we signed conditions, President, Prime Minister, and the President of our Parliament. I personally went to Strasbourg with such a paper, and I think that our membership in Council of Europe helped us a lot to change many things in our country. And if today we don't have death penalty, because we are members of Council of Europe, 90% of our public opinion, they want to restore death penalty. And we don't have it because we are members. That's why I think that also Europeans have to understand that not only sit and wait and say, you are clever, you have to do it, but also to help us if we want to create common community, common space. And this is our common responsibility to do it, and not only to say, you have to be prepared, and when you are guy and well prepared, then we will accept you to our family. This is not, we cannot wait at the third question. We cannot wait that military people will agree to create anti-missile system. We have to create conditions to push them to that agreement, and conditions through civil society. I think that when we, with the Geremik, we started to think how to improve our relations. And when with Bartashevsky, with Chemashev, we started with people from culture. Because our cultural relations between artists were great. We started with people from Academy of Science. A lot of scientists from both countries, they worked for many years together, and they had good experience how to work and cooperate. And we organized with President Putin and President Kwasniewski a meeting between two academies of science in Moscow. It was a great event, and it was necessary to continue between young people, young generations. It means we have to work not only waiting our governments and military people to discuss between them, but also to enlarge our contacts and cooperation between civil society. That's why I was speaking about human capital. We have very strong human capital, which we don't use enough to create new conditions and to create the conditions of trust. I repeat all the time, trust, because we may speak, make beautiful speeches, but without trust, it's not easy to go ahead. And about modernization of the administration system,
I think that I agree that it doesn't move quite well. I think that it's necessary to, but many people understand more and more that it's necessary to also to move with administration reforms, and this is not only North Caucasus but also other regions in our country. But this is not easy problem, and because it is political, economic, and social, and religious, many other things together, and it's necessary to be very careful, because you cannot do that in one part of the country without thinking about the consequences in the other part. But I think that today everybody recognize that it's necessary, and maybe after elections we can see or can expect some further reforms in the administration system. Thank you.
If I may make some comments. First of all, I'd like to agree with Professor Legwald that the Russian leadership, I would say for the last 25 years since Gorbachev, have understood what needs to be done to modernize Russia, to build a better and a more prosperous Russia. They understood that. The problem is with the implementation, and that's also fairly evident why the implementation is difficult. In a sense, Russia is still governed by Soviet state institutions that have been privatized by bureaucrats. And since there are over a million and a half of them, it's quite a problem to change that machinery and that system. And there are the other problems, the vastness of the country, the decrepit infrastructure, the Soviet mentality in parts of the population. I mean, it is a difficult process. Mistakes are being made, and there are differences of view. But I think the Russians know what should be done. We who sit here know what should be done. We also understand why it's not being done so fast. I don't think it's much use, much worse for the Western countries to tell the Russians what they should do. I think that's rather counterproductive in a sense. What the Western countries can do, Western public opinion can do, is to have an indirect influence upon Russia in order to sort of make Russia change faster in the direction we and the Russians want it to change. And just to sort of enumerate again actions that should be taken and can be taken. First one, get Russia into WTO. I think there is a meeting of the WTO Council in December this year, and the decision could be taken after, what is it now, 18 years of negotiation. Take the decision, get Russia into WTO, get Russia committed and bound by WTO regulation. And then abolish the visas. I'm in great favor of Schengen. I mean, it has simplified life for many West Europeans. But one problem with Schengen is that any decision must be taken unanimously by all the, whatever it is, 26 or 27 countries. And so it's the lowest common denominator. It's a very slow process on the EU side. Still, I would encourage, and have encouraged various conferences, national parliamentarians to push for this in their parliaments and with their governments in order to speed up a decision on the EU side. But again, Russia, in its own interest, could unilaterally tomorrow abolish visa requirements for Western citizens. Ukraine has done that, Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan is on the way of doing that. It's just foolish to keep on with that. And again, free trade as a consequence of a WTO entry. Proceed with CFE to ratification. Can be done immediately, and that would be a very important goodwill gesture. Starting talks on tactical nuclear weapons. Hillary Clinton said no, she was not in favor of withdrawing American tactical nuclear weapons from Europe. Well, change that position and talk to the Russians about their tactical nuclear weapons in Western Russia. A number of things could be done which would promote trust, as Igor Ivanov was talking about, the importance of trust, overcoming these fears and prejudice. These things should be done. And that's the only way, sort of from bottom up. Thank you.
Well, our session departs pretty far from the discussion of the common modernization in Europe and in Russia, and I guess it could be expected. My point would be that I guess the failure of modernization would be not only our failure, it would be our common failure for Europe both and for Russia. I absolutely agree with Ambassador Hirman when he said that the crisis have a big influence for, let's say, mentality of Russia's elite. For example, the recent crisis, 2008-2009, we have, our economy was very badly damaged. We have the biggest slowdown among the G20 countries. And despite, I believe, timely and very heavy government programs, we still do not reach pre-crisis indicators of the GDP. We're supposed to reach it in the time of the next year. So all these talks about Eurasian development, about sovereign democracy, it's absolute already. And political elite understood necessity of modernization and Russia's dependence from the world economy. You know, in the eve of the crisis, our Minister of Finance speaking about isolated island in the sea of the crisis. Everybody understood that this is fake attitude. So we are going together and to separate it very much. Our energy interdependence, unbelievable. Europe could not exist without Russian hydrocarbons. We also could not balance our budget without this petrol and gas euros. Regarding the WTO, of course, it's a very sad story. You know, in some sense, it reminds me the Turkey attempts to be the member of EU. Finally, we do understand that it's not a reality, and the same could happen with Russia. This 18-year struggle, we have an agreement with European Union long ago that we do support European Union position for the climate change, and European Union abolish all preconditions for our joining. Then Americans start to implement their claims. So this agreement with European Union failed, and we fulfill all our promises in the climate change conference. So this is the indication that to blame only Russia is not correct, I guess. Of course, there is very strong resistance for membership of WTO domestically. And this is resistance from the part of our big business, as we call them early winners, who capitalize from the lack of competition on domestic markets, who profited with the weak institutions which would be implemented together with WTO, as well as OECD. This is precondition for, let's say, innovation economy in Russia. But you have to understand that. Again, we have some disagreements regarding after Zborka, car assembling, which is supposed to be debated in December. It's a bit artificial. Maybe it's a small minor failure for the car makers in Europe, but it's big gain in general. So you have to wait your attitudes. I agree with Ambassador again when he spoke about the infrastructure, but I guess no less dangerous challenge for Russia, this is demography. We are now elaborating and adjusting Strategy 2020. It would be economic program for the next president. And we believe that our economic growth would be close to 4.5% till the year 2020. But to meet this target, with the declining population, we have tremendous growth of labor productivity. And we have to rely on immigrants. And unfortunately, our reservoir for immigration, Central Asia, do not able to produce the labor force of the necessary quality. So I guess we have to compete for the labor force from Ukraine, Belarus, and Moldova, maybe even from Poland, because today a lot of managers are working in Moscow. Another story about the capital flight, which is mentioned. This is true. It was not very easy explained event in the first 6 months of the current year when the macroeconomic situation was more or less okay, when the oil, crude oil was high, and we faced this capital flight. And what is the explanation? This is a part of this explanation is the exit strategy of elite. Any transaction was not very high, 500,000, 2,000,000, 3,000,000, but altogether it means in the situation of political instability, unpredictability, the elites prefer to move their families abroad. And the transaction cost of this exit is less than cost of normalization of their life in some provincial Russian city. I mean normalization in the sense of the education of kids, healthcare, security, and so on and so forth. This is a reality. And we saw it, and we discussed it with our prime minister openly, absolutely openly. Another limits, hydrocarbons. Of course, this produce unbelievable disproportion in macroeconomics, in finance, and of course, it produce rent-oriented model of the behavior of the people. In this strategy 2020, we suggest that we have a legally bounded decision that these petrodollars have to be used just like in Norway or in Chile. But this situation have to be legally designed and decided by the parliament. Without that, it also could be difficult to go further with these problems. And now there was a question about the democracy, slow development, and so on and so forth. Let me give you some figures in this regard. It's recent surveys. Today, our youngsters, the people, let's say, below 25, they believe that their career would be connected not with the business, but with the civil service. 50% of the people in the age below 35, that they believe that their personal well-being not dependent with their real efforts. This is rent-oriented behavior. And it's interesting that on the eve of the crisis, 75% of the population would be ready for the regulated prices, and 50% supported idea of the nationalization. And this is also reality of our society. And still, in Russia, 60% of the population do not approve the private property. This is society where we live. And this is reality when you talk about our democracy. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Gentlemen, we still have 5 minutes. I wanted to ask you one question just at the end. It's no doubt that we all wish for Russia's success. Your success, Russian success will be our success. If only because, as Professor Langeveld said, we have to stick together in this changing world. We, transatlantic community and Russia, Vladivostok to Vancouver, we have to stick together. If we don't stick together, we'll be a small minority and we'll be eaten alive. Now, you can't stick together with somebody you don't trust. Simple. This is the context of the modernization that I understand. So it is important for us that Russia modernizes fast. Our experience now, I'm talking about Polish experiences, that the close relationship with Western Europe and then membership in European Union has helped enormously in this process of modernization. As you've mentioned, Minister, you know, death penalty, membership in that kind of institutions brings standards, brings good practices, examples of good practices, brings peers pressure on you as well that you should behave differently and so on and so on. So I believe it is all of those who want to bring together Russia and European Union are working for the benefit of both sides. It's important that we succeed in this process. What is the most important thing we here should do to make it more difficult for you to get closer to Europe? Ambassador has made the list of practical things, of important things. I also believe very much in all the measures which bring people together. But as I said, I feel people are getting closer together, but I don't see states getting closer together. The Russians I see here in Poland or in Zakopane in particular, They're just like me and everywhere. They're Europeans, we are the same family. The states are different. So what do we do? What shall we do to bring us together? One thing? Well, we'll start with Russian friends.
I think that starting with my experience as minister and as Secretary of Security Council, I don't believe that in one day we can change everything. That's why I think that we have to, in different tracks, to do steps, but every time thinking that it's necessary to move ahead. It means we can take Russian-Polish relations. We had meetings on high level, but after meetings, after visits on high level, waiting the next visit. But then the group of difficult issues was created, and they started to work permanently, trying to close positions on Katyn and other issues. And we see the result. The trust comes not from statements and from visits. Trust comes from small but concrete issues in different fields, not only in military and security, but also in normal life. That's why I think that we have to, from my point of view, we have speaking, for example, with Americans about reset. The main thing is today, as Bob said, to maintain the relations, because it's clear that today the political situation in Russia and in the United States is that we cannot take serious decision in disarmament issues, but it's necessary to maintain contacts, negotiations, and the same thing with the European Union. With European Union, all last years we were discussing about prices on gas, and this is not correct because we have many other fields, and the bureaucracy of European Union resisted to speak, and also our bureaucracy. They only think speaking about the problems, but we have a lot of things between different. Many, not many years, 10 years ago, we created a special embassy in Brussels, a special embassy to deal with European Union. In that embassy, each ministry had and has people there to speak with commissioners. It means, but there is no dialogue. I think that this is what is necessary: dialogue in different tracks and different directions, but permanent dialogue and trying to not only to resolve problem, but to establish new kind of relations. This is how I see everyday work. Small, but small steps, but steps every day ahead. This is how I see.
Well, I would say that it comes together, bringing people closer together brings states closer together. It is a slow process. It takes time. But, if you would get Russia into the WTO, I think that would be beneficial also for state-to-state relations and creating a free trade area between EU and Russia, the same thing. Taking these measures in the field of arms control. That would bring states closer. It's a slow process. There are things that affect this process. Sometimes the Russian prime minister uses a very harsh language, which talking about the policies of other countries, and that affects public opinions, that affects parliamentarians, and that affects governments. So I mean, restraint on both sides is certainly helpful. As Igor Ivanov mentioned, the fact that the push for NATO enlargement of the Bush administration has ended, that helped to achieve the reset in Russian-American relations. That's a good thing. So I think these two processes, bringing people closer together through traveling, tourism, abolishing visas, so on, and bringing states closer together, it goes together.
And the other thing is predictability. It's very important to understand what other side is doing. For example, in December in Lisbon, we spoke about anti-missile defense system, and we agreed to work together. And when the United States take decision to install radar in Turkey, the question is, it's clear they say against Iran, but if you decide to work together, it cannot be unilateral steps. And not only this is one example, but you may have the other example. If we speak about to create something together, we need to discuss energy or anti-missile defense system or other systems, and not only to think about your interests, but also interests of the other side.
Just one specific thing. I agree with everything that Igor Sergeyevich and Ambassador Hidman said at the basic critical level in the way things will change in the longer run. But the one thing that would change the relationship in the next 2 or 3 years in the short run, notwithstanding my long-term perspective on modernization, would be if we are successful in creating missile defense cooperation that's U.S., NATO, and Russia that we're struggling to negotiate these days. Everybody who's involved in the business, including national leadership, President Medvedev, President Obama, Secretary General Rasmussen, national leaders in Europe, people in the security community, all use the phrase that missile defense cooperation will be a game changer, because it is something that will have significance far beyond a more efficient mechanism for dealing with the threat. Parenthetically, I happen to agree with Ambassador Herdman. I don't want to disappoint my colleagues in this other enterprise. I think the whole idea of ballistic missile defense against Iran is unfortunate, and I'm sorry that we're going down that path, but we're going down that path, and therefore cooperation is critical. If we can achieve cooperation across these three entities of Russia, NATO, and the United States, it'll have to produce a transformation in threat perception on all sides that are involved with this, Baltic states with respect to Russia, Poland with respect to Russia, Russia with respect to NATO, and it will, in a most fundamental sense, create a different basis by which the sides interact. It's the only thing in the next 2 or 3 years or 5 years that can have that kind of measurable impact.
Thank you.
Well, I guess everybody agreed that there is three secrets. It's institutions in all forms, it's trade and investments, it's people-to-people contacts. You're asking why so few Russians are in Poland, or maybe I misunderstood your question, but looking at my sons, they're in their 30s. They have 1 year in wintertime and 1 year in the summertime vacations. The working is very, life is very hard in Moscow. So 1 week in Italy and 1 week in Switzerland or Austria, that's it. They have no time to visit Poland, to visit Baltic states where we spend our vacations. So we have somehow to reinvent the pleasure of being in Poland, in Zakopane, in other places. This is our task. Another advice, political correct language about Russia. Playing off all these stories about imperial past, so on and so forth. I do remember when Moscow were blown up by explosives, by terrorists. I met people who called Chechens as a freedom fighter. You know, we have to be accurate with our language, because this produced very negative impression in Russia. And ballistic missile defense. Of course, I agree with Bob, but the threat assessment, of course, difficult. You know, I do remember that Condi Rice said that this is against North Korea and Iran. The serious people laughing about that. You know, to put radars in Poland against North Korea, then Condi withdrew this notion immediately. Well, again, strategic people in Moscow do understand that this anti-missiles positioning in Japan, this is against China. I do not continue this line of consideration, but I guess I'm very clear. Thank you.
Thank you so much. I understand things do take time. And some processes are slow, as you said. Although I must say that I do like slow-cooked meat, but I'm much more impatient as far as international relations are taken. I think we need a game changer. Reset and missile defense is a game changer in U.S.-Russia relations. We need a game changer in EU-Russia relations. And it's up to you, Mr. Ivanov, me, Markus Merkel, first of all, Russia and Germans, Poles together to come up with such a game changer. Thank you so much for listening to us. I think it was fascinating and times interesting and enlightening panel. Thank you for listening to us.